David's fierce loyalty to Steerforth and his total lack of consideration for Emily may well appear strange to you. They certainly do to me. And at this point, 21st century sensibilities and Victorian morals are shown at their most divergent. What gentlemanly qualities does Ham possess that Steerforth lacks? Clearly, Steerforth has money, prestige, class, education, breeding, good looks and intelligence on his side, but what he lacks, and Ham possesses, are a loving heart, loyalty, frankness, and a self-sacrificing nature. That word nature is not just casually used, as the differences between Ham and Steerforth can be seen as encapsulating the nature versus nurture debate, which was one of the key questions addressed by the fledgling Victorian social sciences. An American literary classic was first published in this month, Nathaniel Hawthorne's Scarlet Letter. Dickens met Hawthorne in Boston on his American tour in 1842, and they remained friends and mutual admirers. And a partnership between Henry Wills and William Fargo resulted not just in the birth of Wells Fargo, but another famous company they established in this month, American Express.
American Express?
That'll do nicely, sir. And would you like to rub my...
And on March the 31st, the paddle steamer RMS Adelaide sank in the English Channel on a voyage between Cork and London. Were the passengers wearing their patented Cork life preservers? Or would this iconic headline have appeared in the Irish press? Cork man drowns. The end of March saw the appearance on newsstands of the very first instalment of Dickens's weekly miscellany, Household Words. There was an inspiring preliminary word by the journal's esteemed conductor, followed by the first part of Lizzie Lay, a novella from the pen of Elizabeth Gaskell. The 24-page Tuppenny magazine soon established itself and built up a steady circulation of around 40,000 copies a week. Dickens himself would go on to publish both A Child's History of England and Hard Times in his journal, as well as over 100 pieces on a wide range of topics, including some of the finest campaigning journalism of the 19th century. I just happen to have in my collection a Victorian silk umbrella, which I shouldn't have raised, expanded, or inflated, or whatever one's supposed to do with such an implement, as the superstition is that it's unlucky to do so indoors. Ah, my finger! Many of the parts carry ads for Sangster's alpaca and silk umbrellas, and such an accessory is what completely obscures Miss Moucher from David's view when she appears, or rather doesn't appear, on Peggotty's doorstep in chapter 32. Much could be said, and much has already been written about umbrella symbolism in Dickens's work. But I'll simply note here that its pointedness and roundness, and potential uses for thrusting and protection, endow it with properties that confound identification with one gender or another. In this part, Sangsters announce their new parasol for the season, optimistically launching it in March, given the poor reputation of the English summer. Quite what the lady seen here carrying a raised parasol is protecting herself from, robed and bonneted from top to toe, and with the parasol shading her right shoulder, is hard to determine. However, functionality is subservient to the impression. As a fashion item, it was an essential component of a lady's toilet, with over 30,000 being sold in the previous season. Interestingly, as a prosthetic extension to the body, such an accessory is not simply carried, but worn. In an earlier video, I read the passage which shows David falling under the spell of Dora, and not a little of her fascination is attributable to her name. Naturally, it suggests that she's adorable, or, in French, d'or, golden and precious. The etymology of the name, though, is Greek, with a meaning of a gift. A fuller version of the name might be Theodora or Dorothea, both of which mean gift of God. Incidentally, both Dolly from Dorothea and Teddy from Theodore, those baby substitutes so beloved by little children, signify that they are gifts of God. Dan Peggotty receives a frosty reception from Mrs. Steerforth and Rosa Dartle when he asks if Emily will return as a lady. In other words, will Steerforth marry her? The emphatically negative response shows just how rigid the class and patriarchal structures of Britain were at the time, and Emily, in most respects the victim, is even blamed for damaging Steerforth's prospects. This busy scene shows the surprise of David and Peggotty on finding that Aunt Betsy and Mr. Dick have decamped from Dover and installed themselves in his chambers. "My dear aunt," cried I, "why, what an unexpected pleasure!" We cordially embraced, and Mr. Dick and I cordially shook hands, and Mrs. Crupp, who was busy making tea and could not be too attentive, cordially said she had knowed as Mr. Copperfield would have had his heart in his mouth when he see his dear relations. "Hello," said my aunt to Peggotty, who quailed before her awful presence. "How are you?" "You remember my aunt, Peggotty," said I. "For the love of goodness, child," exclaimed my aunt, "don't call the woman by that South Sea Island name. If she married and got rid of it, which is the best thing she could do, why don't you give her the benefit of the change? What's your name now, P?" said my aunt, as a compromise for the obnoxious appellation. "Barkis, ma'am," said Peggotty, with a curtsy. "Well, that's human," said my aunt. "It sounds less as if you wanted a missionary. How do you do, Barkis? I hope you're well." The former Peggotty's late husband, Barkis, is famed for the catchphrase, "Barkis is willin'." After his death, how does the line, "Barkis is willin'," take on a new meaning? Until next time, God willing.